Thank you. O God, you show forth your almighty power chiefly by reaching out to us in mercy. Grant us the fullness of your grace, strengthen our trust in your promises, and bring all the world to share the treasures that come through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Children, you come forward.
Bring me a little water in a vessel so that I may drink. As
she was going to bring it, he called to her and said, "Bring me a morsel of bread in your hand." But she said, "As the Lord your God lives, I have nothing baked, only a handful of meal in a jar, and only a little oil in a jug. I am now gathering a couple of sticks so that I may go home and prepare for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die." Elijah said to her, "Do not be afraid. Go and do as you have said. But first, make a little cake of it and bring it to me. And afterwards, make something for yourself and your son. For thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, the jar of meal will not be emptied, and the jug of oil will not fail until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth." She went and did as Elijah said, so she as well as he and her household ate for many days. The jar of meal was not emptied, neither did the jug of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord that he spoke to Elijah. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the book of Hebrews. For Christ did not enter a sanctuary made by human hands, a mere copy of the true one, but he entered into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God on our behalf. Nor was it to offer himself again and again, as the high priest enters the holy place year after year with blood that is not his own. For then he would have had to suffer again and again since the foundation of the world. But as it is, he has appeared once for all at the end of the age to remove sin by the sacrifice of himself. And just as it is appointed for mortals to die once, and after the judgment, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly waiting for him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Stand as we welcome our gospel.
It's not an occupation you go to school for any longer. Jesus, it was a scribe were those people who were taught to read and write in a world where very, very few people knew how to read and write. And they were employed by government or religious institutions or wealthy people to do exactly that. And by their knowledge of reading and writing, they preserved knowledge for other generations. And they also interpreted laws, and for all those peasants who couldn't read and write, that was part of their job. In a world that looks alarmingly like our world today, where nearly everyone was poor, and some people were really, really poor, and just a few people were rich, scribes were kind of in between. Very small, in-between sort of space. So, when Jesus goes to the temple in Jerusalem, there would have been all sorts of scribes running around that place. Okay? And they're the busy working bees of the temple, and they are doing things around there that the high priests don't do. They work for the priests, in fact. And the priests are very, very wealthy people. In the day of Jesus, the full-time priests and the high priests, because they only come from the wealthiest families in the day of Jesus. And they are people that have been raised to get used to the good things that wealth brings. You know, good clothes and fancy feasts and honor just for having the right family name. The scribes, they weren't that wealthy. Okay, they weren't. But to the peasants that are listening to Jesus teach, the scribes look a lot more like the priests than like themselves. They likely wore better clothes and likely went to feasts that these peasants couldn't even imagine that are listening to Jesus. Likely got honored when they walked into the street because of who they were close to, the proximity of the high priests that they served. And because the scribes are human, they liked those things, the perks of the office, so to speak. And Jesus tells them, these peasants, to beware of these scribes who work for the temple, who like their perks just a little too much. Let you into the back door of preaching right now to show you how the sausage is made for us, because this is the point in the sermon now where I tell you who those scribes are in our world today, okay? Because we don't have scribes anymore. In order for us to get anything out of this, we have to figure out who those scribes are. And when I was doing this over the weekend, after reading about this all week and writing the sermon over the weekend, you know, I started making those usual lists that Lutheran pastors make when they, you know, want to pick on some people in our world. Televangelists with jets, okay? Okay, sounds like the scripture right here. Megachurch pastors with exorbitant salaries. Okay, put that one down. High church officials from any denomination, not just Lutherans, that expect to get treated with such honor and have these bloated staffs. Okay, we'll pick on them a little bit too. And here's the bad thing. I mean, where this sermon is meant to go, where this train is headed, is the widow's mite. I'm going to make you all feel bad about not getting two pennies in that thing, okay? But I just need to get there. But as I was making the sermon up this weekend, the bad thing about doing research and reading and stuff is sometimes you hear something different that might need to get preached. Because all those people I just mentioned that I was planning on picking on, they don't look like scribes. They look like high priests in Jesus' day, maybe, and Jesus has plenty to say against them, too. But this one's about scribes. And if I want to find who looks the most like scribes in our world today, in our religious industrial complex, that might be me. And as soon as that came to me this weekend, as I'm writing the sermon, I got really defensive. I even wrote down a whole paragraph on why that isn't me, right? I mean, for one thing, no one ever accused me of dressing nice in this world. I mean, if I didn't have 12 different Messiah Lutheran shirts to wear, then you'd see me in a $20 Kohl shirt. I mean, that's all I own, right? I mean, even my nice robes come from Pastor Hartman. Right? And that's because he thought I looked so shabby and something had to be done. Yeah, this guy's not me that Jesus is talking about. And I don't even know if I've ever been to a feast in my life. I've been to a lot of potlucks. Lord knows I've been to a lot of potlucks. And when I go to potlucks, I eat more than anybody should in this world. But I will tell you this, I always go last in line. I make it a point of being last in line. And that's an important thing at a potluck, because when you go last, all you're left with is vegetables by the time you get up there. There's sacrifice in there. In fact, I don't even tell people that I'm a pastor out in the world, except, of course, police officers when they pull me over. And I don't expect any other honor from this. And I'm writing all this down, and I'm remembering Pastor Bowman, Dr. Bowman, my seminary professor, something he said a number of times in class that's always stuck with me. You know, whenever we find ourselves defensive, then we're likely close to some sinfulness. Whenever we find ourselves defensive, something's being pricked inside us. We're likely feeling guilty of some sort of sinfulness. So rather than just march on to the widow's mite, I say, guys, what is that about? And you know what? You people pay me a very good salary to be your pastor. We just finished the 2016 budget that we'll show you in December and vote on, that the council looks at it in November. And that 2016 budget is going to say $79,000 plus some benefits, what my pay will be. Now that's within the ELCA guidelines. You know, we don't send that. That's what the, but the reality is, a quick Google search will show you that that amount of money is more than 75% of Americans. And if you add in my household income, then we make more than 95% of Americans. You know, though I dress shabbily, drive a 10-year-old car and worse, a $15-year-old $1,000 scooter. I'm rich by the standards of not just the world, which is terribly poor, but America, which is a rich country. And Jesus is going to talk about scribes who are rich, relying on the temple. Then I'm going to have to hear that as judgment on me. I'm going to have to play with that. I mean, Jesus didn't nail the things that I love, the perks of my office that I enjoy. But there's things I like about being wealthy. But he could say, and so I'm asking a different question. What do I do when I see myself convicted in Scripture? And it sounds like Jesus could be talking to me. What do any of us do when we're reading or studying or listening? And we hear ourselves being called out. I think the first thing all of us should do is go to the waters of our baptism and do what our brothers and sisters, our Catholic brothers and sisters do whenever they pass, is put our hands in those waters and let it wash over us again to remind us of our baptism. When all of our sins were first washed away, where God called out our names and said that our grace, God's grace, would be with us. When we heard a promise that no matter how filthy and far away from God we become in the world, God's love won't leave us. and remembering my baptism, I can have a confession about who I become. Not out of courage, because what courage do you need to confess to God who already knows everything about you anyways? What courage do you need to confess to a God who promised to say, I forgive you no matter what words come out of your mouth next? But confession nonetheless, in order to hold up for ourselves what might need to be changed. And from that font, and that confession, I move to the table where I'm fed at a feast that will not fill up your belly necessarily, but it will fill up your life. A feast where the greatest honor comes to those who do get last in line. A feast of God's presence that nourishes me in the midst of my brokenness, that nourishes us when we're feeling convicted. It gives us strength to go out into the world and be who God wants us to be. The hope of God's creation. The fancy church word for that is to repent, to change, to turn around, or at least think seriously about what change could look like. If we're on the same strand of thought for myself, then that means that we need to take seriously that tension that the church has of people relying on the church for their income and the work of the church in God's world. We're called to be fair to our employees, maybe even be a model for others in fairness to our employees. On the same hand, we have a lot of needs for that wealth that's being shared. As a leader of the church, I need to encourage our council to take all of our salaries in the church seriously. Am I within guideline? Has anyone checked out the guideline lately? Or do we just keep telling ourselves that? Can we call the bishop's office and see what that looks like again? Should we go further than that and call up other churches in the Columbus area and see what they're paying to pastors of similar-sized churches with similar responsibilities? See what that looks like. Does this make sense? Is this fair without being unfair to the ministry God calls us to work and live? Should we even go further than that and look at the responsibilities in education and figure out how does that compare to other jobs in there? Those are things we need to be doing as a church. That's our responsibility. Because, quite literally, if we are misusing the money of our widows, then that's something worthy of condemning. And the other end of that is more personal for me. What am I doing this great wealth that God has given me? I believe, which I hope you believe, that in the waters of baptism, each one of you has gotten a gift that's been released that's exactly what God aches for in this world. More than one. I've got all sorts of gifts that God needs used in this world to meet those aches. But one of those gifts is surely wealth. I need to come to terms with that. I need to come to terms with the fact that if you read what Jesus has to say about wealth, it ain't good. Wealthy people have all sorts of stumbles and false starts that they have to deal with. You don't have to feel sorry for them, be sure. But I need to understand why Jesus thought it was so hard to be faithful and wealthy in this world. Am I sharing abundantly as I've been called to? Am I sharing abundantly with our church? We give $15,000 a year to Messiah. Sounds like a lot. Is it a lot compared to what our household makes? We've got to ask those questions. You know, if you read the pastoral letters of Paul, Paul says that the wealthy person in a family is the one responsible for all the things that go wrong in that family. That's what he says in 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy. You know, I'm supposed to be the guy willing to write a check when siblings and cousins get into financial distress. Willing to support parents as they age and money runs out of their savings. Willing to launch my kids into the world. Am I being generous there? And maybe even more importantly, my gifts won't meet all of God's needs. But nearly all of God's needs in this world include money for ministry that will be done, that can be done. Am I being generous with ministries in God's world? Ministries like Heart, Food Pantry, or Joseph's Coat. So questions I gotta ask, that I need to ask. Here's the thing. If all of us read Scripture, convinced that Jesus is always talking about somebody else, then none of us are ever being honest with ourselves. And what's that about? If we don't trust to hear God's judgment in light of the grace we've received in baptism, then what do we believe happens in that water? But if we embrace our baptism, the forgiveness we've already received, why not ask ourselves tough questions that will move us forward in God's world to be God's hope? Amen. Please stand. Let us sing him 7 times.
made alive with God in Christ. We pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. Compassionate God, bless and watch over those who do not have enough in this world. For the homeless in our city, for those who cannot afford medical aid, and those who are uncertain of their next meal. Empower those who live with plenty to remember those without. Remind them of your call to be with and care for the poor. For those who have enough to make a difference are called to live your promises in the world. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful God, be with and protect all those who are fleeing from political violence and war. Grant peace and healing to the nations they are fleeing from, and open the hearts of those with whom they seek refuge. We also pray for our nation and leaders, as well as our national enemies. Give all governments and peoples wisdom, that peace may prevail throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy. Healing, Lord, send your restoring spirit upon those who struggle with chronic illness. Wrap them in your loving arms as you are with them in their struggling. We pray especially for Mary Horton, Kimberly Beery, Meg Breidler, Tish Roberts, Harold Kohler, Matt Kelly, Lynn Rempe, Linda Resch, Doris May, Al Schreider, Ben Briner, and Jean Fisher, grieving the loss of her sister. And all those prayers we lift up now, silently or aloud. Lord, we ask that you grant all those we pray for wholeness of body and soul. Lord, in your mercy. Gather these concerns and all who are in need into your abundant care, O God, remembering your promise of mercy through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
We share a sign of peace with your neighbor.
stand as you sing and receive these good gifts. Sign of the new covenant shed in my blood, for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Remembering his love for us on the way and at the table and to the very end, we proclaim the very mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We pray for the gift of your Spirit in our gathering, within this meal, among your people, and throughout the world. Blessing, praise, and thanks to you, Holy God, through Christ Jesus, by your Spirit in the Church and without him. Amen. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us. Come to the table that God has set. You may be seated. We'll have our assistants come forward to prepare to serve all of you this meal of God's presence. Everyone's welcome. Thank God.
Take away the sin of the world.
Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Now, Pastor Brennan.
Hello. I've been hiding in the back doing worship. Today is our harvest concert and dinner. So come on back for that. 3 o'clock is the concert. It'll be a really great time. All of our groups and groups from around Reynoldsburg, other churches will be joining together for a really great concert. And then at 4:30, we have our dinner. If you are someone who, you know, by Sunday afternoon, you're like, I am tired, I want to eat at home, you can do takeout and still participate and help out with our fundraising efforts for Heart Pantry. But otherwise, you come 4:30 and 6:30 is dinner together here. And as you can see out there, silent auction has started, so go on out and start putting your bids down. You know, this is donation, so you don't have to do every $1, right? You can add an extra 10 or whatever. And I only say this because me, as a strategy person, I was looking, I was like, oh, I can just add $1, and I'm, you know, I'm like, no, it's for fundraising, right? So this is actually my thought process. Confirmation is meeting at 5:30 today. Kids can stick around after confirmation to help clean up. And so that'll be something they'll be doing in service today. And they're headed out to Vinton County this weekend, so we can be praying for the group as they head out for that this weekend. High school, their time is moving. 4 o'clock, we're meeting here to help with the dinner. And then we will go over to the Parsonage and have pizza together and fellowship together until 7:30 at the Parsonage. But we'll meet here at 4. Let's see. So you'll be getting those grocery bags today. You can fill it up with the good stuff. And we'll be giving out food from those bags. And then also Joseph's Coat is gathering coats, adult coats, but especially children's coats. So if you can go through your closets or maybe you see some stuff on sale, you can bring those in for Joseph's Coat. Otherwise, any other announcements are on your bulletin board. I invite you to stand for our benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen. Amen.
Our sending hymn is in your bulletin. 873.
Thank you.
Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.